Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is April 8th, 2018. This is the second Sunday in Easter. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508.
Good morning, and welcome to our worship service this morning. If you're given a crossword puzzle, the question is a three-letter word for the Sunday after Easter. The answer is low. I don't open that low Sunday. Traditionally, this is called Low Sunday because, of course, after all the attendance on Easter, the common Sunday drops off quite considerably. So, if you're ever going to cross with us, that's the answer. Also, I see most of you got the announcement. Gina is sick today, so there is no children's church because of her illness. So, and Mary is playing in Illinois with the Wittenberg softball team, so no children's church. Today, we have to use our hymnal for the entire service, so please take out your red hymnal. Our worship book that you find in the pew, ask that you turn to page 94, and like those, Nancy is saying she will take over children's church, so young people, if you want to follow this list, you can go back to the children's church.
Thank you.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Song. we have seen with our eyes, what we have looked at and touched with our hands concerning the word of life. This life was revealed, and we have seen it and testified to it, and declare to you the eternal life that was with the Father and was revealed to us. We declare to you what we have seen and heard, so that you also may have fellowship with us. And truly, our fellowship is with the Father and His Son, Jesus Christ. We are writing these things so that our joy may be complete. This is the message we have heard from Him and proclaim to you, that God is light, and in Him there is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with Him while we are walking in darkness, we lie and do not do what is true. But if we walk in the light as He Himself is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, His Son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, He who is faithful and just will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make Him a liar, and His word is not in us. My little children, I am writing these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. And He is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. The word of God.
Thanks be to God.
Celebration of the resurrection of our Lord. Thanks to those who decorated and those who
cleanup, measure, grid, help with communion, whatever. And those of you who attended, your participation is greatly appreciated. And the only other announcement is Wednesday night service resumes this Wednesday, 6:30 in the chapel. Those of you who regularly come to Wednesday night, we will be meeting again this Wednesday. Now I ask that you give your attention to the Lord.
And it may not be a literal room,
such as a bedroom or a house or into our household, it can be our mind and our heart, that we can lock them up like they're in a room with locked doors and do so because of some kind of fear or anxiety. That is the case in our gospel lesson today. It is the evening of that first Easter Sunday. And we read that the disciples are locked up in the upper room. The doors are locked, probably the windows are shuttered, and they are there because of fear of the Jews. And then suddenly, Jesus, the resurrected Jesus, comes and stands in the midst of them and gives them the greeting of peace be with you. Now, what can we learn from this first evening Easter event? Is it simply a historical record of one of the resurrection appearances of Jesus? Or is there some lesson that we can take with us each and every day? The reality is, of course, that not only is this a historical record, but there is an important lesson for us as we continue our pilgrimage on earth as a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ. Again, think of the setting. Now, Jesus had appeared to Mary Magdalene. The other women had been there and seen the tomb empty. Peter and John ran to the tomb and found it empty. But they still don't believe that Jesus has risen from the dead. They won't listen to Mary. They won't listen to the other women. John and Peter evidently don't even believe their eyes. And suddenly Jesus appeared. What this is saying to us is that in our lives, as I mentioned, we have a tendency to lock out our heart and our minds from certain things that we don't want to deal with. And the first thing is that we lock ourselves into a room due to enemies. As we read, on the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews. Literally, the entrance being closed where the disciples were for fear of the Jews. That word fear means to be terrified. It means to be alarmed about something. It means to dread something. And as I said, if it's physical, where you lock yourself in your bedroom or lock yourself in your house, you dread the knock at the door, you dread someone calling you because you want to be alone. Of course, what I can think of, what reminds me most of, is being a kid, locking yourself in your room because you've done something bad. You hope that your parents will go over there and calm down before you have to deal with it. But this happens to us, as I say, with our hearts and our minds in everyday life. We lock off our mind and the room of our mind and our heart to the enemies we have, and by doing so, this prevents reconciliation. This prevents us from being able to develop a friendship out of a difficult situation. And so we examine this event and we see that Jesus came and stood among them just like he will come and stand among us. Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, peace be with you. The phrase come and stood means to show up, first of all, show himself openly, to suddenly appear, and to make yourself visible. The word among them means to remain or to abide. So the lesson for us is that even in dealing with our enemies, Jesus remains and abides with us, giving us the strength to open the door of our mind, our heart, to that enemy to bring about reconciliation, to bring about an end of hostilities. Of course, we're talking about a personal relationship. We sometimes, unfortunately, can open our hearts and minds having an open heart in mind to them, didn't work. The only thing they understood was the barrel of the gun, or the tank, or artillery, these bombs dropping from the sky, shooting from the air. But Jesus remains with us and abides with us so that we can open up that door, that room that's closed in our heart, even to our enemies. But where he helps us is the most is when we are facing fear and anxiety. Fear can cause us to do all kinds of, I don't want to say crazy things, but fear can cause us to act in a way we normally would not act. It can cause us to become frightened of things in which we have no need to be frightened. The story is told of President Theodore Roosevelt as a child, known as Teddy. And one day he told his mother that he would not go into the Madison Square Church ever again by himself. And when his mother asked him why, he said, "Because I heard the minister say something about the seal would eat me up." He says, "So I'm not going in that church unless somebody's with me." So the mother was kind of confused about this, so she got a biblical concordance. And she looked up the word zeal and then began to read the young Teddy every passage that had the word zeal in it. Finally, she came to John 2:17. John's account of Jesus cleansing the temple. And in verse 17 it says, "And the disciples remembered he said," now of course this was the King James Version back in Titus. And so it said, "The zeal of thy house hath eaten me up." So of course little Teddy, not understanding what the word zeal meant, thought it meant that something called zeal was lurking in that church building and it literally would eat him up. Now in our modern translations, it's a little easier to understand what Jesus is saying. He says, "Zeal for thy house consumes me." In other words, that Jesus' desire to see his house, Father's house, be a house of prayer, motivates him and dominates him and fills him full of this energy to see that it's so. But of course, when you're little, you hear that something eating you up or consuming you, you think the worst. So that fear caused little Teddy to be scared of his church. That's what fear does to us. It causes us to act irrationally. But here we see Jesus saying, "Peace be with you." And that peace is always with us. And that word peace means to sit apart or to sit at one with someone again. It means an absence of strife. He's talking about, of course, as Jesus uses this, that we are set at one with God. That through his death on the cross, through the shedding of his blood, he has paid the debt of sin that we owe, that separates us from God. And now because of that, and having risen then on that third day, he now sets us back in a proper relationship with God. So that God does not see us as sinners, but instead sees us as his children. Sees us as followers of his son, Jesus Christ. When we stand before God, and Satan accuses us of all the sins that we've done, God does not pay attention to that. And God does not see that. All he sees is one who's been washed in the blood of his son, who through faith in the death, resurrection, and ascension of his son is washed clean and has a place in his eternal kingdom. So when we are fearful, when we are anxious, we should think about that peace that only Christ can give us, that peace that passes all understanding, and that he's with us and dwelling with us no matter the situation. There was an old farmer sitting out on his front porch smoking his corncob pipe when a stranger came along. And the stranger pulled over, got out of his car, and asked the farmer, he said, "How's your cotton doing?" Obviously, this was
Stay up and try. He said, well, how are your taters doing? I ain't got no taters. Scared of the tater rugs. And he said, well, when did you plan? He said, nothing. I'm playing it safe. See, fear caused him to act totally irrational. I'm hoping, because the story doesn't say, I'm hoping he had cattle and pigs and sheep, so he had some way of having an income. When harvest time came, he had nothing to harvest. Or maybe he had an orchard and apples or something in it, because he was going to need an income. But that's what fear does. And we see that daily in our life where we lock ourselves away from something because we're scared to death of it. Or we don't want to try it. Or we're fearful of what we might lose if we do that. But Jesus comes and says, peace be with you. The word also means to, as it's used as a greeting, before Jesus, it basically meant, may you be saved from trouble. So when two people would greet each other in the Middle East and say, Shalom, Shalom, may you be saved from trouble. With Jesus and his crucifixion and resurrection and ascension, now when a Christian says that, it basically has the meaning of not, may God give you every good blessing. A blessing, blessings through faith in our Lord Jesus Christ, so that we can continue life, so we're not crippled by life. Fear cripples us in life. Fear cripples us from enjoying things. And look, I'm not ashamed to admit it. You've heard me admit it many times. I'm afraid of flying. I've flown twice in my life, and that is two times too many. And so people say, well, you're missing out on a lot of things if you don't fly. I say, well, if I can't get to my car, I don't need to see it. Well, I can pull up the Discovery Channel and National Geographic Channel and all these other education channels, and I can tour Germany and Ireland and Scotland and every place in the comfort of my easy chair and not worry about what nuts on that plane with me. So people would say, I'm crippling my life. Some people, my grandma always said, God wants us to fly to give us wings. That made a big impression on me. That my dad and mom were all the time. They were heading across. But that's what fear does to us. We're afraid just like those disciples in heaven. The doors were locked. And the thing is, when we lock the doors to try to keep out our enemies, we lock ourselves in so we can enjoy anything. Comes and stands among us, abides with us, remains with us, and gives us that peace that only He can give, so that we can continue. There was a tragic story in Time magazine back in 1988 about a gentleman who had died in East Detroit. No, he didn't die by gun violence. He didn't die by cause of gangs in Detroit. Shooting it out, whatever. He had been, for recreation, he'd been a trapper. And he had enjoyed going up in the Upper Peninsula of Michigan and trapping different animals. And he had been bitten by, of course, his share of ticks in doing that. Well, then came out about 1988 about Lyme disease, which is carried by deer ticks. And if you get bit by a deer tick, you can get Lyme disease, and I guess it can be pretty rough to get over. Or it can cause death in some cases. So he became obsessed with the idea that he had been bit by a deer tick and he had Lyme disease. And so he went to the doctor, and the doctors tested him and said he was negative for Lyme disease. Yet he still would not believe. He became so paranoid. He was sure that he had given Lyme disease to his wife, even though the doctors told him they were 99.9% sure that you could not transmit Lyme disease to another person, simply because you had been bitten by this deer tick. postcard telling him he had another doctor's appointment to be tested for Lyme disease and that they could not. That is what happens when we lock ourselves in a room because of fear and anxiety. We do that, which is totally irrational and totally out of the ordinary. But it was too late for that husband and for his wife. But Jesus comes and unlocks our doors of fear and anxiety. Jesus comes and unlocks those doors of whatever it is that is bothering us so that we can go back out into life and live life as Jesus intended us to live. He is the one who opens the door to life and to liberty. Liberty, not political liberty, but liberty from sin, death, and the power of the devil. Liberty from being a slave to materialism. Liberty from being free from bondage to the things of the world that try to tell us they are more important, but they are just trinkets, as we know, that disappear or can be stolen. So Jesus is the one that comes and stands with us to give us that strength that we need. One day a little four-year-old girl had to go to the doctor. And her dad took her. This is back in the day when I was little. And the doctor decided that because of what the little girl had, she was going to have to get a shot. And if you're my age or older, you remember what shots were like back then. You know, the needles look like they kill elephants. You know, our grandkids are so lucky that they go to the doctor and the needle's not that long. They get shot by them. Remember that picture in Life magazine of poor recruits in the Army during World War II? They showed the guy standing there, and there was a nurse on either side with a needle not that long, inoculating for some kind of disease so that he wouldn't catch it when he was sent overseas. This is the kind of shot we're talking about. And when they stuck you, you knew you'd been stuck. And not only were they long, they were thick compared to the needles in them. So anyhow, the doctor came in with that shot and the little girl saw it, and immediately her face became anxious and she tensed up her body, which of course, those of us who have received shots for over 50 years know that when you tense up, it makes the shot worse. You got to relax. Well, she was tensed up. She had this look of anxiety and fear on her face. And suddenly, her dad reached out and took her hand. And he looked directly in her eyes. And she looked into his. And as she did, she became calm. And the look on her face changed. And it wasn't anything that he said. It was just his presence there with her that gave her that confidence and comforted her as she received that shot. That is what Jesus does for us. He comes to comfort us and be with us in those difficult times of life, as well as the happy times of life. One Christian theologian has said, quote, Jesus didn't come to do away with suffering. He didn't come to explain it. He came to fill it with his presence. And that is what gives us the confidence to face each new day. That is what gives us the confidence to unlock our doors of fear and anxiety and go out into the world and experience the world to its fullest. Because we have that presence of Jesus, the resurrected Jesus, with us. We don't have to put our fingers in the prints of the nails. We don't have to take our hand and put it in the side of the spiritual surface. We know that Jesus is with us. And we know that Jesus being with us, we can face any trial, tragedy, trauma, disappointment, setback, on this second Sunday of Easter, learn from the event in the upper room with the doors locked. And learn that you do not have to be paralyzed like that in life, but by faith in Jesus Christ, by truly believing in his death, making payment for our sin, through his resurrection and ascension, he is with us so that we can be calm and be comforted each and every day of our lives, so that the locked rooms can become open. Amen. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. We will now sing "Shall We Gather at the River," hymn number 423 in the back of our worship, and number 423.
Creator of heaven and earth, I believe in Jesus Christ. Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended to heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Time for our offering. Janet Leach and Connie Singleton will be passing the plate.
Those who came with that difficulty, please stay. Let us pray for the whole Church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Our response today is hear our prayer. Father of glory, remember your church throughout the world and strengthen all your baptized people to be both witnesses of our Lord's resurrection. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Found of wisdom, everlasting, look in kindness upon our synod, that all we undertake together may be to your praise and glory. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Ruler of all, to your care and protection we commend all our elected officials and all who serve in our armed forces. Grant them wisdom and honor as they carry out their responsibilities. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Heavenly King, your Son promised that he does not break the bruised reed or quench the dimly burning wick. Remember in mercy all who struggle with the darkness of doubt and despair, and bring to their hearts the peace of your Son's resurrection victory. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Forgiver of all sins, you have given your church the keys of the kingdom. Help us all to use them faithfully, that your people's joy may overflow. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
O Lord, our healer, we commend you all those who are in need of restoration, whether body, soul, or spirit. Grant to them your peace, that they may bear their sufferings with patience, as they wait your gracious healing. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Everlasting one, receive our thanks this day for all who have fallen asleep in faith in Jesus Christ. Bring us to share with them the joys of the feast that never ends. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
And your hands, O Lord, with him and all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us
as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
May the Almighty and merciful God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, keep you in his light and truth and love, now and forever.
Amen.
We conclude our worship with Christ is risen, alleluia, hymn number 382, in the back of your worship, hymn number 382. Thank you.
risen indeed.
Go forth in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God. That concludes our Sunday service. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508. Our choir director is Vicki Perks. Our organist is Greg Nolte. St. John's has a food pantry open Wednesdays 9 to 10:45. The outreach store is open 9:30 to 1, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and Friday, closed on Thursday. Rainbow table every Friday from noon to 1. Everyone is welcome to share a meal. St. John's Sunday services are at 8 and 10:30. Starting Labor Day weekend, our 8 o'clock service will be at the Melody Drive-In east of Springfield on Route 40. Services, rain or shine.